goes by so slowly. Time goes by so slowly.
Coco's was originally called Camden Palace, and I have history with Camden Palace. I played, I did my first concert in London there 23 years ago. Oh my God, that is so frightening. Yeah, I did a gig there 23 years ago, and I think I was scared shitless. Scared of England, scared of, I don't know, being in a foreign place. When I first came to England, it was all about Boy George and World's End. And I remember I came to Camden Palace to see a concert before I performed there, and Boy George was there. And he was completely dressed up in the whole Malcolm McLaren thing. And I was I was so intimidated by him. The idea that people took fashion that seriously and took it that far and were so extreme. It seemed like everything here was more extreme. There was more of a music scene. There was more of street culture. There was more, I don't know. I guess it was exotic to me.
Oh my God, there's cameras everywhere. It's freaking me out.
Yeah, we're going through our rigorous warm-up routine here. Look, there you go.
Oh, stretching. Oh, go on, Marcus. Our age as well.
My band consists of Stuart Price, Steve Siddell, Nick on drums, who's been with me since the Drowned World Tour. He's amazing. Actually, before that, he played on my music album. Monte Pittman is my guitar player, and he's been my guitar teacher since my son was born. That's when he started playing guitar again. And finally, Marcus Brown on keyboard. And he's also been with me since the Drowned World Tour, and they're all amazing musicians, fun, easygoing.
Do you like your suit, or is it hideous?
Mine's really the wrong size to judge it. It looks like I borrowed my fat uncle's suit.
Didn't they have your measurements?
Yeah, and it's like they turned it's like they read the bit of paper upside down or something.
They thought you had really big shoulders and a really tiny bum.
I look like David Byrne in Stop Making Sense.
Gigantic shoulders. Yeah. I want to see those suits on you because I'm a little worried about them.
I feel the same.
I don't have words in my vocabulary to describe how I feel about those shoes.
The white with the light.
Yeah, the white with this purple, yeah.
Yeah,
that's
really good.
See that.
Yeah?
Yes.
Let me just feel that.
Yeah, go.
We got somewhere for us to change.
No, just go back there. We've got to rehearse.
What about me?
Get that thing off now.
What about me? I look like I'm here to film another Star Wars movie. One of the extras.
It looks like a fucking Klingon.
I mean, Simon.
I'm C-4-3-2.
That's the scariest thing I've ever seen. I think those suits all cost £100 each. You get what you pay for, okay? Monty, you shouldn't let people dress you like that.
For you. Okay, next time.
You can't let your scruples
fall.
Especially that far.
You gotta have, what do you have to have?
Standards.
No silver suits.
I'm suffering from oxygen deprivation. Okay.
You should have seen Stuart in his silver suit.
I'm glad I didn't, because
the one he looked like
I'm not sure if I could collaborate with him anymore.
greatest respect in the world. It was shit.
I'm down with the program. Okay, let's stick to white. It's safe. John Travolta wore it.
Yeah.
He looked cool.
It fits us.
It fits you. I don't have to spend any more money.
Basically, we're here at rehearsal. You know, kind of going through our paces, if you will, with the dancers, you know, kind of matching music, the music with the band and what Madonna's kind of laid out for us in these five songs, and then making the dancers match that movement. So we're here just putting it all together, staging it. I'm overseeing that, as well as you know, making sure that the stage looks appropriate for her. You know, the costumes come together for the dancers with Madonna. All the video screens are working and compliment her and what she looks like and sounds like and what the vibe is for the show. So basically, and in other words, I'm kind of like Madonna's manservant. So, you know, hey, whatever, I do whatever she wants me to do. So she basically comes to me, she gives me the vision, what she's looking for. We have 5 songs, and I make sure that, you know, everything gets executed. Manservant number 1, Jamie King, yes.
Dancers I think I have on this promo tour are my favorite dancers that I've ever worked with. Well, see, what happened is when I did the Hung Up video, I went looking for new dancers and I brought in Cloud and Miran and Aries, who were on my last tour. And then when we went to Lisbon, we sort of chopped and changed things around a bit. But I've got a new group of dancers, Leroy Barnes, otherwise known as Hypnosis. And Miss Prissy, I found out about them through David LaChapelle. They were in the documentary Rise. They're amazing dancers. And then Stephen Norman, my two French Algerians who are amazing. They're from Gay Perry. And the rest of them are just people from Reinvention.
They're all individuals, which is wonderful, but with individualism, individuality rather, comes, you know, all kinds of great headaches for me. Madonna loves these people because, you know, they're all characters in their own right. She loves to choose dancers that can really stand out and really that are stars on their own.
Go get Jamie and tell him that these shoes right here. These shoes right here. I don't know what the hell's wrong with them.
You right? It's a stand up. It's about that. Okay, who's missing?
Something's not quite right.
You right?
You know what? Don't tell nobody, but I'm gonna go ahead and be Emma's backup singer. You know, I got the little thing that you say, oh, don't fit up. Tired of waiting on you.
Ring, ring, ring goes the telephone. The lights are on, but there's no one home. Tick, tick, tock, it's a quarter to 2. And I'm done, I'm hanging up on you.
He is like this amazing combination of He's like a black Fred Astaire. He's like Sammy Davis Jr., young Richard Pryor, Chris Rock's little brother, and I don't know what else, but he is a badass, and I can't believe he's 18 years old. I mean, it freaks me out that he's such a baby, and he's just a ball of talent waiting to explode, and I'm like, I could do anything.
Hey, this, I'm auditioning for the new Harry Potter. I'm the new villain. Peep this out.
He's a comic genius, and I discovered him, and no one can have him but me.
Hey, don't get this. Well, you get this.
You know what? I'll tell you why he doesn't want you to get that. He's rubbish, mate. You're rubbish. You're well rubbish.
I had such a good time when I did the European Music Awards. I felt like I got shot out of a cannon when that disco ball went up. It was a blast. It was the first time I ever performed Hung Up ever in front of an audience. And the live audience at the European Music Awards, it was as great as a live audience when you're on tour. And that doesn't happen at award shows. So that was really fun and exciting. It was just fun. You know, I wasn't even aware that we were doing a TV show. That's how much fun it was. And there was a real sense of camaraderie backstage. All the artists were supporting. I mean, I hung out with Chris Martin from Coldplay, hung out with Green Day. Robbie Williams said really nice things about me when he got his award. I gave an award to Bob Geldof. I felt a lot of love and not sort of people being jealous of each other like you usually feel in like those kind of shows where everyone's in competition with one another. So that was a really nice feeling.
I think the what's going to be exciting about the Coco show is what we've done is we've combined kind of the DJing aspect of the record of this style of music with a live band, and that where the two kind of meet, it's, I don't know, I think both me and Emma always thought the good thing about DJs in clubs is they do stuff like, you know, they turn the music down for a bit and then they you know, kind of turn it back up into the chorus, and you do all these kind of effects that a DJ can do, which didn't seem possible to do with a band. So, in very basic terms, what we've done is taken the live and run it all through my DJ setup, so that it sort of gives us this ability to kind of present live music, but with a DJ nightclub dynamic.
Mirwes recommended Stuart to me when I was doing the Drowned World tour, I said I wanted a keyboard player who was cool, young, hip, cutting edge.
But I was a kind of utility, extra sort of keyboard player at that time. And we started working kind of first in the band sort of situation, which then progressed to, I mean, I'm less of a good keyboard player, but more good at looking at the overall thing, getting all the sounds together. So then I started working as musical director, and then after the second tour of kind of rearranging songs and remixing songs, it just kind of spilled over into doing a record, because it was essentially you're doing the same thing, rearranging sort of collections of, you know, found sound into tracks. So the only difference was, instead of remixing old songs, we were coming up with new ideas and then effectively remixing them to make new music.
I'm gonna sing live and you don't?
Yeah. I mean, the whole sort of theme of Confessions on a Dance Floor really is the theme of having a good time. It's the soundtrack to a party, or it's the soundtrack to driving around in your car, or it's the soundtrack to not overthinking things and living in the moment. That's kind of what it is. And it came about out of necessity for her wanting to do that in her life at that point, and that was the music that I'd been doing as a result of DJing around the world for the sort of 3 years before that.
You know, I never set out to make a dance record. In the beginning, I was just writing music with Stuart for a musical, and then that musical, the script came, and I didn't like it, and Hung Up and I Love New York were the songs we had written for that script, and I said, okay. Stuart had been taking the dub mixes of Hung Up around to clubs everywhere, because as you know, he's a DJ as well, and he was getting such an overwhelming response to that song that I decided, you know what, let's make all the songs dance music, and kind of that's how it unfurled.
You know, for me, this album is extra special because it's, you know, it's Madonna kind of returning to her roots. I mean, it's a dance album, you know, she's like the dancing queen, if you will. So for me, this is like, you know, it's like a dream, because all the music works really well with choreography and movement and dance and staging. Which is what I'm about, and realizing that kind of those kind of things for her, and making sure that her stage looks right and it moves correctly with her and her music.
Hi, I'm Steve Stelnick. I've been playing drums a long time, and my age is 42 years and one day, and I'm now going to interview the band.
Without Steve Stelnick, there is no life.
Steve and Marcus are from the north, which gives him a cheeky kind of unintelligible charm. A bit chauvinistic.
There was a young man called Dave who kept a dead whore in a cave. It was not for this leisure. He took to the pleasure. But think of the money he'd save.
Monty's from Texas, so he's like a southern boy, and he likes to draw when he talks.
Monte Pittman is a simple man.
Yeah. He's from Texas.
He's from Texas. I don't sound like I'm from Texas.
No, you don't.
Not in any way, but come from Texas. Live in Los Angeles. Proud parent. Proud husband. Proud endorser of Orange Amplification.
Go Orange.
Orange. The voice of the world.
Stuart's from Reading. What can I say? Have you ever met anyone from Reading? Stuart and Ricky Gervais, that's it.
Did they get Jesus' name wrong, is the question.
Oh, they most likely did. Because Jesus was not Latin. I think he was British.
From Reading?
Possibly.
The whole ABBA sample hung up thing was a bit of a sort of happy accident. I mean, like I said, she was working on the soundtrack for this musical that it was going to be at first. And when we were talking about doing the dance, the disco section, she said, you know, I kind of want it to be like, you know, ABBA for the future. And at the same time, I'd made this instrumental track up that used that loop from ABBA just because I was DJing every weekend and I wanted something new to kind of take away and play. So it just happened to be around at the same time. And when she said, I want something like ABBA but set in the future, well, here was this track that I'd already been using in clubs and I'd seen the kind of response. So it was just, I don't know, sometimes, you know, like I say, happy accidents and coincidence and things fall into place at the right time, and that track was around at the right time, and I think that's why that became the starting point for the record.
That was Stuart's idea. I never get ideas about samples because samples cost money. But that said, if you're going to sample something from ABBA, because their music is killer.
It's the one problem about everyone in Madonna's band. They're always doing crack.
Should I tell you the songs?
I am doing Hung Up, of course, Get Together, I Love New York, Let It Will Be, and I'm doing Everybody, an old, the first song I ever released as a single in my entire career. So, combining the old with the new.
Light in my eyes, okay?
probably wonder why I'm eating an apple now. Well, I'm eating an apple now, so that way this tooth don't become like this tooth. If you really look at it, it's a tooth like right there. It's an inside. Sometimes the apple will get stuck inside there. But look, to all them kids out there, an apple a day keeps the doctor away. A banana for you, you'll save a tooth. One orange. That's it. That's all you get. That's all you get.
We'll see you in the sequel. I want to tell you another secret.
Yeah. Here's one you haven't heard.